Welcome to First Lutheran Church, where you're among friends in Christ. I'm Reverend Thomas Rothy. I'm glad you've joined us today, and it's my prayer that the Holy Spirit, working through the gospel, touches your heart and changes your life. May the Lord bless you today and throughout the rest of the week. Our first or Old Testament lesson is recorded in the Old Testament book of Isaiah. We read the 7th chapter, beginning at the 10th verse. Isaiah foretells that the miraculous virgin birth of our Savior is a sign from God that He is Emmanuel. We read, "Again the Lord spoke to Ahaz, 'Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights.' But Ahaz said, 'I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test.' Then Isaiah said, 'Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and we'll call him Emmanuel.'" Here ends our first lesson. A second, or epistle lesson, is recorded in Paul's letter to the Romans. We read the first chapter, beginning at the first verse. "Rejoice that Christ, true God and true man, came, that we may be saved by grace through faith." We read, "Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who as to his earthly life was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was appointed the Son of God in power by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him we received grace and apostleship to call all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith for his name's sake. And you also are among those Gentiles who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be his holy people, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ." Here ends our second lesson. Alleluia. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel. Alleluia.
Son of God. Amen.
gospel lesson for the day, which will also serve as our sermon text, is recorded in the Gospel of St. Matthew. We read the first chapter, beginning at the 18th verse. Matthew presents the birth of Jesus from Joseph's perspective. May we follow this example to live in obedient faith. We read, "This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, 'Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.' All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet: 'The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel,' which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus." Here ends our gospel lesson. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Once again, our sermon text for this morning is a great portion of today's gospel lesson. Dear friends, in the coming Christ child. Christmas is only a few days away. Are you prepared? Some of you might still have some shopping to do and gifts to wrap. Maybe some of you still have to head to the grocery store to buy various items for your Christmas dinner. Maybe some of you still have to bake pies and cookies to complement that Christmas dinner. In the midst of all these last-minute preparations, don't forget about the most important preparation. The preparation of your heart for the Christ child's entrance into the world. The portion of God's Word that we have before us this morning redirects our thoughts to that first Christmas, the day that our Savior took on human form to save all mankind from sin. This morning, then, let's meditate on the theme, From Heaven Above to Earth He Comes. First of all, of Mary, chosen virgin mild. And then secondly, from all your sins to set you free. If you noticed, I borrowed as our sermon theme a variation of the title of the hymn that was just sung. The parts of our sermon are taken directly from the hymn and hopefully lead us to a greater understanding and appreciation of the mystery of Jesus' incarnation. Matthew's account of our Savior's birth is probably less memorable to you than Luke's account. But while Luke's account is more memorable, it's Matthew's account that focuses on Jesus' incarnation, the fact that God became true man in order to save all mankind from sin. Our sermon text tells us, this is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. From heaven above to earth he comes. From the opening words of the hymn, Luther leaves little doubt where Jesus came from. He came from heaven. God's one and only Son left his home in heaven to come down to earth and take on human form. The method God chose to have him do this was to have him born of Mary, chosen virgin mild. Of all the young women in Israel, Mary was the one specially chosen by God to be the mother of the Savior. And if the birth of the Savior wasn't special enough, God had him born of a virgin. This pregnancy is part of the mystery of Jesus' incarnation. Human reason just can't fathom it. Joseph couldn't either. He had in mind to divorce Mary and dissolve the marriage, on the grounds of her being unfaithful. No sooner had he thought this, an angel appeared to him and announced that Mary's pregnancy wasn't due to unfaithfulness, but because the conception was caused by the Holy Spirit. Joseph believed the angel's message and took Mary home as his wife. Like Joseph, believe the angel's message. And then, like Joseph, prove your faith by grasping how wide and long and high and deep the love of Christ is. Show your appreciation for this miracle of love. Praise and thank God for the gift of His Son. Praise and thank God through public and private worship. Praise and thank God by living the Ten Commandments. Praise and thank God by sharing Jesus' love. Yes, appreciate what God the Father has done for you through the gift of His Son. It really is life-saving. Our sermon text also tells us, she will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. From heaven above to earth he comes. And why? From all your sins to set you free. The Virgin Mary gave birth to a son. Whose son? Not Joseph's, but the Holy Spirit's. Joseph, however, was to give him the name Jesus, which literally means the Lord saves. Matthew wraps up this section of Scripture by recording the fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy, leaving little doubt that Jesus is that promised Savior who the Old Testament people so looked forward to. The first prophecy, or promise of a Savior, was given way back in the Garden of Eden. Remember? I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. This prophecy, or promise, was given after Adam and Eve had fallen into sin. Because they ate of the forbidden fruit, they would surely die. Meaning, experience eternal separation from God in hell. But God followed up that promise with another promise. The blessed gospel promise of a Savior from sin and its punishment. The Savior is Jesus. Take a moment and marvel at how God loved you so much that he sent his one and only son, born of a woman, born under law, to redeem those under law. In spite of your continued sins of thought, word and deed, he still loves you and saves you. But don't just marvel dumbfounded with your mouth wide open. Marvel in awe. Marvel at how God could love you, a lost and condemned sinner. Marvel at how God could have his Son take on human form. Marvel at how God the Father would subject his Son to the law and have him fulfill it on our behalf, thereby buying all people back from sin, death, and the power of the devil. I guess all of this marveling could be described as not taking Jesus for granted. How could I do that this time of the year? I couldn't. But what about 6 or 7 months from now, when it's summer and there's a million and one things to do? Isn't it easy to take Jesus for granted then? Don't take Jesus for granted at Christmas time, summertime, or any time. Marvel in praise and thanks for his grace and mercy. In a Midwestern city, it was customary to set up a nativity scene in the center part of the city's park. But one night, the baby Jesus went missing. Someone had taken the life-size figurine, which symbolized the true meaning of Christmas. The local newspaper covered the story and reported that the city council expressed the hope that baby Jesus would be returned before Christmas Eve, and added, it would be difficult to find a replacement. How true. Only Jesus, true God and true man, was born to suffer and die for the sins of the world. Have you prepared your heart for the Christ child's coming? Make being in the Word your preparation. From heaven above to earth he comes. Of Mary, chosen virgin mild, from all your sins to set you free. May the Christ of Christmas bless you now and always. God grant it, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Let us now join in confessing our Christian faith according to the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Christian, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lord, and sing his praise. Tell everyone what he has done. Let all who seek the Lord rejoice and proudly bear his name. He renews his promises and leads his people forth in joy. With shouts of thanksgiving, alleluia, alleluia. Hear the prayer of your people, O Lord, that the lips which have praised you here may glorify you in the world, that the eyes which have seen the coming of your Son may long for his coming again, and that all who have received in his true body and blood the pledge of your forgiveness may be restored to live a new and holy life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another. Serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Spending some time with us today. You have been watching First Evangelical Lutheran Church of the Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod. Reverend Thomas Rothy invites you to tune in again next week, or if you have the opportunity, to worship with us live on Sunday morning at 9:30. First Evangelical Lutheran Church is located at 231 Smoke Tree Lane, Prescott, Arizona. If you are in need of spiritual assistance or would just like more information, please call 445-2807. May God's word guide you this week.